Hello, everyone joining us today. My name is Stephen Christofferson. I am the Senior Digital Marketing Specialist here at Tech Canada, and it is my privilege to be your host for today's Deeper Insights webinar. I'd like to take a moment and begin with a question. Are your company's policies promoting respect and collaboration, or are they more received like your barking orders at employees? Today, you're about to discover the truth. We are joined by Louis Eisen, the principal of Perfect Policies, and he's joining us for an eye-opening webinar that is going to redefine your view of policymaking in the workplace. In the past, Louis has worked as a lawyer, an IT manager, a business consultant, an information management specialist, and a government policy writer. Now, he combines them all to help organizations around the world rewrite and reframe their policies to achieve maximum cooperation and engagement. He is the author of the Amazon bestseller, How to Make Rules That People Want to Follow, with the fourth edition coming this winter. And his approach to policy drafting is used by organizations around the globe. Without further ado, I'll pass it over to you, Louis. But before I do, I'd like to remind everyone that today's webinar is interactive. Whether you're joining us on LinkedIn Live or in the Zoom event, please make sure to leverage the chat function to share your questions and comments with Louis throughout and to receive personalized insights in real time. So over to you, Louis.
Thank you, Stephen. I've put the city that I'm calling in from. If people just want to tell us where they are, so just as we go through this and compare whether we actually have any regional differences, just enter the city you're calling in from so we can see. I'm going to start. Oh, wonderful. Calgary out there. Somebody out west. All right. I'm going to start by showing you a sign in my doctor's office. Okay. This sits behind the receptionist. What do you think of that? You need to look at that. Can you just enter into the chat one or two words about what your reaction is as you see that?
Sure.
And Stephen, let me know what the reactions are that are coming in on the LinkedIn side.
For sure. I will, as soon as they start coming in, people I think are just listening at the moment. I'll share as soon as they come in.
Yeah, sometimes it takes them a moment to type on this one. How do you react to that? My doctor is very apologetic because the doctor didn't put it there. It's put there by the management of the clinic. And he's not particularly happy. But there's a number of things going on here. So I want to see whether people are catching them. Are we getting any reactions in there yet?
We are just about to, because I made a mistake and the chat function was disabled. It is now enabled, everyone. Sorry about that. Please use it as requested.
Okay, good. That'll help. Ah, good from Rubrezic. Yes, no issue with the intent. Agreed, Terrence. Just the wording. And what strikes you about, what do you see when you see a sign that looks like that? How about now, Stephen? Any responses coming in from the main?
Yeah, we heard one that says it feels a little aggressive. It feels angry. Some of the words that are popping up on the chat.
Oh, really? So no aggressive behavior will be tolerated except our own, is what that is. Yeah, I agree. And Carrie, I'm agreeing with you. It doesn't make you kind of want to actually use their services. There are three main problems with this kind of sign and this wording. And I say, I don't have an issue with the intent. Okay. But the first problem is that we, the patient, coming in, we're nervous, we might be uncomfortable, it's a doctor's office, we'd like to be put at ease. This sign does not do that. Clearly, they've had some problems there in the past. But I don't want to be a witness to an altercation. This is telling me that this place is a tinderbox and may go up. I don't think that does them any good to be telling people that. The second issue I have with it is I highly doubt its effectiveness. Do we really believe that somebody who is mad at the receptionist, steam coming under their ears, ready to go ballistic, is going to look at the sign and say, oh, golly gee, they don't like an aggressive approach. I guess I should change my approach. So in terms of actually effectiveness to the people that you're trying to hit, I have serious doubts. But the worst problem with this is that it makes the entire staff look like they're walking around with their fists clenched, ready for a fight. They can take it as good as you can dish it. One person at that clinic wrote that rule, and yet everybody is wearing it. As it turns out, most of the people at the clinic are really nice people, but you would know it. They wanted to influence people's behavior, but this is not the way to do it. I mean, we all want to influence behavior. We all have cases where we want to be able to direct people to act in a certain way, but nobody looked at this sign and asked, how does this sound from the other end? And given the way it sounds, are we likely to get compliance? Let me tell you a bit about why I got into this field. When I was working for the Government of Canada, my managers came up to me and they said, nobody's following our rules. We have all these rules. We're telling people, nobody's listening. We're wasting our time. So I looked at the rules and they were full of very harsh words like always and never and no exceptions, with lots of bold and italics and underline and lots of exclamation marks. And I realized that rules have a tone of voice, and it's not a tone necessarily that we've been paying attention to. And the problem with that tone of voice is it has created a division between the rule makers and the rule followers. There's an us against them mentality that is surrounding the rule. Instead of that, we're all in this together and here's how we want to be, I'm telling you what to do, or I'm telling them what to do and they're not listening to me. It's creating that kind of dynamic. And this is the typical type of wording that you might see in an organization. You know, flat out prohibition. But we're not just talking about policies that are directed to employees. We're also talking about policies that are directed to customers. Now, I'm never challenging the rule, the content of the rule. Like if you can't accept returns without the original receipt, fine, good. You know, I'm happy with that. But how do you convey that to people? Because there is such a thing as psychological reactance. That's well documented. People see that they're trying to be forced into something and they react. They resist, whether they're resisting actively or passively, or it just takes them a few minutes to come on. You are creating a resistance or generating resistance that you don't need to. If I can quote the great American philosopher, Britney Spears, don't try to change me. Okay. So the goal is for us to lower resistance to our instructions. And the question I think every organization wants to be asking itself is, does the wording of our rules align with our corporate values? And that's the discussion that I'm going to have with you today. You are trying to create an environment. You have a set of values that you are trying to create in your organization. It might be an operational culture of excellence or a culture of safety or a culture of productivity. It could also be a social culture of respect for others and a culture of trust and a culture of collaboration. Your HR people are doing their very best to make the workplace a positive employee experience and trying to show people that you have respect for them as individuals. Your marketing communications people are spending a lot of time putting your brand out there, showing customers that you care about them. And you've got managers and supervisors that are working with staff, trying to set a positive tone and build trust. And all of that work can be totally undermined by rules that send a contrary message. And usually it's just because we didn't look at the message the rule was sending. So what I want to look at today is I'm going to give you a bunch of really badly worded rules. We're going to see, you know, what some of the messages are that come out from them. We're going to talk about where this kind of tone of voice came from. I'm going to give you some techniques to fix them. And then we're going to look at how corporate values and rules, policy rules, interplay together. So I'm going to ask you, does that work for everybody? And of course, I can't see anybody, so I assume you're all nodding your heads, which is great. Let me give you an example of this problem. These are all taken from real cases, although in most cases, the names have been changed to protect the innocent. If you look at this policy, clearly, this group wants 7 days notice for vacation requests. And clearly, again, on the left, they're not getting it. But I think you can read something more in that on the left. I don't think they're just telling you that they're not getting it. I think they're telling you how they're feeling about the fact that they aren't getting it. What emotion can you deduce from reading that paragraph? It's subtle, but it's perceptible. It's definitely there. Can you enter the emotion that you can detect from that paragraph into the chat? Give you a moment. Any responses there, Stephen? So, Frans, you're telling me, I think, what the emotion of the people who are being spoken to, but I'm asking about the emotion of the people who are speaking. The emotion of the people who say any request not submitted on time may be refused. How are they feeling when they say that? Because I think that's kind of coming out in the way that's worded. Thank you. Frustration is absolutely the biggest one. I think it's really clear they're frustrated. They may be feeling disrespected, undervalued, ignored, unappreciated, but those kinds of feelings are showing up here. Now, look, we all get it. We've all had rules. We want people to follow them. Some people don't follow them. We get frustrated. We all get it. We've all been there. Is it appropriate that that frustration shows up in the policy itself? If you're one of those organizations that throws your policies out on the web for transparency, not only will everybody in your company know that the HR group is not getting compliance and is frustrated, the whole world will know that this group that is asking for requests are not getting cooperation and they're frustrated by it. We've just announced it to the entire world. Unfortunately, when we start to write these policies, most of us use a very old formula. It usually starts with the "you must." And in fact, what's happening is that we have a mandatory condition, a requirement, and we've turned that into a "you must" statement. This is a very strong parent-child dynamic in "you must." You can't control your age. What they really mean here, if I can reword this particular one up there, here are three ways of wording this same rule just as strictly, but without the parent-child dynamic. The rule on the left, the important one, that's a bouncer standing at the door going, "Are you 65? Well, not you. Well, how about you? Well, no, not you." The one on the left is an extended arm saying, "Hey, are you 65? I have something for you. You might be eligible for something." It's inviting you in there. Et la même chose existe en français. Il faut, vous devez, very common, but not needed. All we're doing is giving people information. Here's an example of a consumer one that I see all the time. Here's the messages. "You must have this and you must do this." In other words, if my site isn't working, it's your fault because you didn't set up your computer right. There's the message. "You got to do this. You got to do this. You got to do this." What we could just turn this around and sound helpful. It's exactly the same information. But instead of telling people what to do, we're being helpful. Now, sometimes the I've got to respond here. Somebody said that one of the things that shows you is that they have no tolerance for personal circumstances. I agree. There are times when you read the policy and it shouts to you, we're not flexible. We don't accommodate anybody. And that kind of emotion comes out. Sometimes, though, it's a little bit, yeah, there's en français, c'est la même chose que vous devez. Sometimes, though, it's a little subtler. This one comes from an organization. There is a terrible message being given to the staff in this policy. Does anyone see it? It is a terrible message being sent. It wasn't intentional. It was just nobody put their mind to this one. Might take a moment. So, Stephen, if anyone shows up with this one in, let me know. It's stronger than the we must. It's a worse message. Yes, thank you, Taylor. We want the policy to say, we want to train you. We want you to know what you're doing. We want you to be skilled. But it doesn't say that. What it says is apparently the law says that we have to offer training. So here we go. It's not a good message to be sending out. This is from a lawyer's group website. So it tends to have a lot of lawyer's language in it, but this is an example of a policy which is doing a really nice thing and sounds nasty. See, if you look what they're doing, they don't have to let you cancel. They are actually letting you cancel if you give them enough notice. And even though you don't cancel in time, they're also letting you send someone else. But they didn't write it like that. They wrote it like a threat. That, please be advised, that means something very specific. That means, don't tell us you didn't know about this, because we're telling you now. We are advising you. I don't want to hear from you that you didn't know there was an administration fee. That's what please be advised means. But this is very easy to reword. Well, worded like this, we make it clear that we're helping people, which is what we're actually doing, instead of yelling at them. The main question, I guess, that I always look at this is, where does this old wording come from? We must, you must, or you must, you will, it's necessary, not tolerate. Where's that come from? I asked you, where did we first learn about rules? I think most of us would say from our parents and teachers, you know, sit up straight, stop fidgeting. I don't want to catch you doing that again. What we learned from that experience is that rules should sound bossy. If it's a rule, it should sound like I am telling you what to do and you will obey. That was what we learned. But actually, I don't think our parents were modeling that for adults. I think they were modeling how adults talk to children. Not how adults talk to other adults. And most people don't learn that skill. But unfortunately, that parental tone of voice was kept enchained, if you like, in offices for centuries, up until a couple decades ago, when bosses would talk in a terribly parental voice to the people that they were talking to. I know you see me on Zoom or LinkedIn, you probably think I'm 25 years old. I get that all the time. Now, actually, I'm a baby boomer, and those of you of my ilk will remember a time when you might hear a boss screaming at an employee, and there was nothing you could do about it. You just had to put up with it. And it was part of the culture. Employees spoke that way, and they wrote that way. Nobody talks that way today in most organizations. Today, our management, we're concerned about collaboration, about respect for others, diversity, inclusion, work-life balance. Nobody talks that way and gets away with it, but they still write that way. The writing hasn't come up, hasn't caught up to the speaking. And usually it's because it's off the radar. Just nobody thought to look or pay attention at it. I wanted to show you some solutions, some ways that I recommend wording. But in order to know that they will serve us right, we have to make sure that we are all on sort of agreed on what the culture we're aiming for should be. So if I can ask you to go to this site, either use your web, go to slide.do and hit POL. I just got a couple questions about your corporate culture. I'm going to drop the share of this screen and start sharing a Slido screen so that we can see all the answers. My first question, and there's the code again if you still need it. My first question is, how would you rate your current organization? Would you say that you are basically a command and control organization or an organization that works to empower its people? Command and control, very military. We're going to tell you what to do, how to do it, and that's what we expect you to do. Whereas a system of empowerment says, we're going to train you. We know you need to use your discretion sometimes. We're going to give you what tools we have. Let you go out and do your work. Okay, I'm going to give people a couple moments here. I don't know how many people we have online and voting altogether, so it's hard to know when to pull the end here. We're getting an average score of about 3.8 in this group, which I can tell you is generally high because you know what? When I ask employees, they tend to rate their offices much, much lower. Well, let's assume that, in fact, you're giving me an accurate rating of where it is. Still 3.8. If you had the ability to wave your wand and move that bar to somewhere where you think it should be in your organization, where would it go? Okay, so you can see there's somewhat of a shift to the right. It's not a huge shift because people were starting high, but there's a move to try and improve the amount of empowerment. Basically, if you're looking at your policies saying we need to write our rules because we have to keep people in line, we have to keep our customers in line, that's a command and control approach. All right, the next question. Would you say that your organization operates from a policy culture of distrust, a defensive culture, or a policy culture of trust? A culture of distrust sounds like this. If we don't actually have a rule telling people not to burn down the building, somebody's going to do it and say that they didn't know it wasn't allowed. If we don't tell people not to play games while they're surfing the internet, somebody's going to do it and say they didn't allow. That's a culture of distrust. Where a culture of trust says, we tell people that the computers are for business. And they know that surfing the internet is not, you know, playing games is not part of business. That's a culture of trust. So where do people play? So here we're pretty low because most of us are coming from a place here where we're writing defensively. We feel, and some of you may be in unionized environments, and that even pushes a harder toll on you, because in a union environment, you often hear that you didn't tell me not to do it, so I did it. That's something that we actually have to work closer with the unions to try and fix. We're averaging here at 2.6. And if I could ask you the same thing, I want you to wave your magic wand and tell me where you would put this thing. Where would you like the culture to be in your organization? Yeah, much higher. These are important messages that we need to send both to our staff and to our clients, our customers. All right, I have one last set of questions for you. If you look at your organization, if you're a small organization, this may not as much apply. A large organization, it applies to. And if you're like a consultant, think of an organization you work with. The question is, would you say that all the different areas in the office write in silos so that the marketing people have nothing to do with the policy people, have nothing to do with the HR people, or that in fact we're writing together? We have a common message system that gets put across all the organization so that we're making sure we're aligned. Well, I would say the word here is variation. We've got some people who are really common, aligned, which is wonderful, but there's an average score there of about 3.1. Again, wave your wand. Where would you like to see it? Okay. So now we have a sense a little bit about the kind of policy culture that we want to put into the organization. Let me go back to my slide deck. There we go. I want to talk a little bit about how you get around this. How do you work things so that, in fact, we're not getting people's backs up? And I'd like to, if you're not already familiar with it, introduce you to the power of the present tense. The present tense is one of the most powerful writing styles that you can use when it comes to policies and rules. Not office hours shall be from 8 to office hours will be, office hours must be. No, they are. That's the way we do things here. In our office, our policy is that office hours are from 8 to 4. It's plain and simple. Now, some of you may look at that and think, that's kind of weak. You know, my best friend was a policeman, and when he first heard me give this talk, he went, I don't think so, he said. That might work for some mamby-pamby, touchy-feely organizations. Everybody plays lovey-dovey, but that's not going to work for a serious organization like military or police or hospital or anywhere where people actually have to follow the rules, because if it doesn't sound powerful, no one is going to believe they're serious. Is that right? I know a lot of people think that way. Well, from my perspective, as a lawyer, the harshest rules in any jurisdiction are the criminal rules. You know, the rules against the nasty stuff, kidnapping, assault, arson. How are those rules worded? People must never assault other people. It is prohibited for people to murder each other. No exceptions will be made. Yeah, you know what? That's not how criminal rules are written. I'm going to start in the U.S. I don't know if we have U.S. people on here, but there's South Dakota. Look at that. It's written in the present tense. It's just telling you what is. Here's Texas. It's in the present tense. I have done a survey of all 50 penal codes of the United States, and I can tell you that 80% of them use this present tense formulation. 10 of them still use what I think of rather antiquated wording. You know, no one shall set a building ablaze lest they be shackled in the village stocks and flogged before all present, or something like that. But 80% of them are using this straightforward present tense. And if you notice, it doesn't sort of, it's not accusatory. It's not suggesting somehow that this is what you were planning on doing and warning you away from it. Now, I'm pleased to say in Canada that 100% of our criminal codes use this formula. But that's cheating, right? Because we only have one criminal code. So same across the country. But this is not limited to North America. There it is in the United Kingdom. There's New Zealand. Et c'est la même chose dans la France. Le temps présent. So we have an absurd situation in this continent, a lot of the English-speaking world. The strictest laws for the most heinous crimes are worded more respectfully than many of the policies that come out of our organizations. We talk nicer to criminals than to our colleagues and customers. It's just plain wrong. You know, if you worked at one of these organizations with the harsh language, I think you could be forgiven for thinking that murdering your boss is not half as bad a crime. Just looking at the tone of voice, if you murdered your boss, it's not half as serious as leaving dirty dishes on a sink, because you should see the way that rule is worded. This heavy-handed approach is a problem. This one comes from my gym. Rule one, do this. You must do this. Rule two, rule three. This is a yoga class that they want people to come to. And it's just punching you in the face. Punch, punch, punch. This is a real business error when a business uses this approach. And the reason is you do not demonstrate that you value teamwork and inclusion and respect when I can read your rules and it's clear you demand obedience. As it turns out, this organization, they're really nice people. They have a big sign, everybody welcome, you know, we don't know, everyone is included. It's great. But they don't pay attention to the sound of the rules. I tell you, whenever I do this and I show an organization's rule, I do tell them first in the instance of transparency, you know, you might want to change this, you might look at that. And sometimes they tell me where to go, in which case I use them as the before picture. So that's the situation we have here. So I want to talk about three drafting techniques that you can use so that you can avoid the negativity that comes out of most of the way policies are worded now. And those techniques are based on two principles. The first one is assume positive intent. Let's assume that people want to do the right thing and they want you to tell them what the right thing is, but not to yell at them about it as if they're planning on doing the wrong thing. Let's assume people want to comply. Second thing is let's avoid the parent-child dynamic. When I tell you, you must do this, and the kid says why, and the answer is because I said so. That's what the you must statements sound like. Okay, you must wait 4 weeks for a response. Why? Well, because we said so. Not great. So I'm going to show you three techniques. The first one is just using positive messaging. Second one is controlling yourself, not others. And the third one is replacing instructions with information. Here's the first one. This is pretty basic. When we reach for rules, we tend to word them in the negative. It's habit. We're having rules where we think we're being helpful, but if the goal of the rule is for people to look at it and say, okay, I like it, it's very hard to like it in the negative. It's much easier to like it in the positive. So all you need to do for your rules is switch it around and word it in the positive. That will cover an enormous amount. Les mêmes choses en français. Juste de retirer le ne pas, and end up with a statement that just sounds a lot more helpful. So that's pretty easy, right? Number one, use positive language. Number two, if you look at this policy, I think you'd have to agree with me that this is a ridiculous policy. It's a ridiculous policy because you can't control what customers do. You can't reach out there and actually control them. What you can do is adopt your behavior. So a better way to word this, you could say something like, we don't answer the phone after 5 o'clock. That is technically accurate, not particularly insulting, but not particularly helpful either. A more helpful way to say it would be something like, calls received in the evening are returned the next day, or something to that effect. But the lesson here is actually very deep. You can't control what any human does in this world. All you can control is how you respond to a situation you don't like. Whether these are employees or customers or children, you can try and control and give them information, but basically people do things. We have not gotten rid of murder using the anti-murder clause in the criminal code. There are people who still do it. But what we say in the criminal code is, hey, if you do it, you're going to end up in jail. That's the way the criminal code is written. Never says, don't murder, don't assault, don't kill. It doesn't say that. So the response then here is to figure out, how do I respond in a situation I don't want? Theaters and concert venues learned this a long time ago, because they don't want people coming late to the show, but they don't put this on the ticket. That would be pretty off-putting. What they put on the ticket is something like that. This is how we handle this situation. You see, there's no accusation, there's no fault, there's no guilt, there's no finger waving. You're an adult. If you understand that we see late cover, so it takes the old formula. Old formula is thing I don't want you to do, followed by punishment I'm going to give you if you do it. No, it's taking that completely different. Here's how we handle a situation we don't like. Very common in social media that they want to prohibit certain topics or pictures and subjects and whatnot. And most of those prohibitions are a set of rules and guidelines that say, don't put this and don't put this, and this is forbidden and this is prohibited. But Pinterest, however, has done a really good job. Pinterest says, we'll remove or limit it if we find it. It goes through a whole bunch of topics and it says, well, we'll remove it if we see it. Doesn't say don't put it there, but that's clear. But it also opens the door that you might do something inadvertently. It's not accusatory. Okay, you might inadvertently put something in that you didn't realize was exploitative. And so this is they will take it off and you will understand why. And this is not about punishment. It's a whole different approach to rulemaking. So when you start something like this at the top of your form or the top of your instructions, how about instead of telling me what to do, tell me what you're going to do if the form isn't complete, or if the form is complete? I would use something like this. We can process the form once it's complete. Or here's what we do if it's incomplete. This is so non-accusatory here, but you're talking about what you do, how you handle the situation. Okay, the third area is to be informative instead of directive. So we tend to give people instructions again, do this, do this, do this. But this can be very easily turned around to sound informative. This form is complete when it has these characteristics. This sounds less bossy. This sounds like you're not pushing them away, because complete this form properly, do this, sounds like you're pushing them away. Probably isn't the intent. You know, you could also use these exact same words if you did it like this. Get your refund in 3 easy steps. That's a helping hand. That sentence says, we want to help you. Easy steps here. We're trying to help you. Here are the steps, 1, 2, 3. They don't have the same negative punch here, because we started off with a, we're here to help you. Look at the difference in tone. Complete this form properly. Get your refund in 3 steps. Look at the difference in tone it makes and the kind of compliance you'll get. So those are 3 techniques, and I want to move now to values-based policy. Actually, before I jump in, I should ask, are there any questions that have come up, Stephen? Or are there any questions people want to throw at me now? Feel free. I have this one last section on values-based policy, and we'll have some time for questions after, but...
No questions so far. Many people joining the chat. I think there was a little bit of technical difficulty with the LinkedIn live chat, everyone. So maybe use the comment section, but it's working for some, I know. So no questions.
Can you feed me any of the, summarize some of the comments we're getting?
A lot of people commenting on how the policies make them feel, how they would resonate. And it's people are pretty seeing the obvious poor versus great and the differences that can be made. The tweaks that can really take something from one level to a whole other dimension. So,
good. Yeah. You know what? This is almost like people tell me after they come to this session, they see these things everywhere. It's like you've now learned how to identify small cracks in the ceiling, and now you see them everywhere. You didn't see them before, but now you see them. I want to talk about values-based policy. You remember, because I started with this. Does the wording of our rules in the organization align with our corporate values? And so far, the only corporate value that I've been talking about is really respect for others. That's the corporate value that has driven all the rewording we've done so far. But your policies need to align with your corporate values, even at a higher level. I first came across value-based policy when I needed to move my book from paper to Kindle format, electronic format. You may know that Kindle still has some monochrome devices. In the book, I have black text and burgundy highlights. Well, you can't use burgundy in the Kindle because it doesn't show up properly on the monochrome. So they have a policy about what you can use. It's a good policy. They could have done it wrong. They didn't do it wrong. They did it great. But I'm going to show you what wrong would have looked like first. This is what wrong would have looked like. And if I had seen this, I would think probably exactly the same thing you're thinking now, which is, those are the five ugliest colors I've ever seen. So aside from that, I'm wondering, how come I don't get to control this? I'm the author. Why do I not get to choose the color that works best for the work? They didn't do that. Here is Kindle's policy. And you see, they used the word we again in there. When choosing colors, we conform to the World Wide Web, W3C Consortium, recommendations for a readable contrast ratio. I get that, of course. This is for readability and accessibility. I get that. So then they gave me a standard that I could use, a formula that I could use to reach it. Get a right RGB color. I played with it a bit. It was a bit tough. And then I said, you know what? It really would be great if I could have some examples of colors that I could use. And now when I see this, this doesn't bother me at all. I understand exactly where this is coming from. We can map this to documentation. So this is a map of the type kinds of documents your organization writes. It's got three levels. Foundational are the things you write to make your business work, starting right at the top: mission, mandate, vision, values, etc., principles. Those are all the things about how your organization is going to work. Under that, you have very specific authorities, policies, standards, and procedures that guide a certain number of topics. They can be technical, they procedural, but they implement the strategies. Underneath that, we have all kinds of guidance, being our best advice, our recommendations, our examples, all this other stuff. It's not the rule itself. It's all the stuff we use to explain the rule so people will understand it. Those are the three types. And I can take the Kindle policy and map it here. The policy is we adopt these standards. They gave me the standard, and I have some examples. This is an easy case to reverse engineer because most of us are familiar with the notion of making screen visible and accessible. But when I ask people what's the value here, they usually say this is about usability or accessibility. But I have to tell you that usability and accessibility for most cases is not a value. It is a strategy. It implements a value. We didn't care about accessibility for years and years and years. So all of a sudden we care about accessibility. What's driving that? I don't want 100% of things accessible. I want barriers around dangerous things. I want barriers around private things. So I don't want barriers in this case. What's driving the accessibility? What's the value behind it? I'm going to give a moment just in case anybody's got a thought to enter it. I have to tell you, when you're looking at ultimate value, this takes a while. Sometimes you really have to think. But I would put to you that the ultimate value here is inclusiveness. That's why you want it to be accessible and usable. Nobody left out. That is ultimately driving this whole policy here. And on top of that, we need some principles. When I objected to the bad policy I made up from Kindle, I objected on two bases. First basis, the colors are ugly. That tells you that my value is aesthetics. The second basis is I'm the author. I want to do what I want. So that tells you that my value is personal preference. So we need some statement from the organization saying inclusiveness is more important than aesthetics. It's more important than your personal preference. Now I have a full paradigm here where I can see how a particular policy supports a strategy all the way up to a value. Okay, I'm going to let you just look at that for a sec. We have copies of this form, by the way, and it's a fillable PDF. Stephen, if you can make that available to people.
Definitely. And for everyone joining us on LinkedIn Live, it will be available on the Tech Canada website with the recording of this webinar by the end of the week.
Excellent. Okay. So this one is a pretty straightforward example. Let me give you another example that isn't quite as straightforward and show you why this needs to be a problem that we need to look at. This is a very common type of policy I see in an organization. And when you ask why, you say, well, because I said so. No, what's the why? What is really driving this? Because I don't even see a policy there, frankly. What I see when I look at that is a standard and a time to use the standard. And the standard is mandatory, but I don't see the policy behind it. I don't understand the strategy. I don't know what's driving it. Now, if I asked you, what is it that is the value driving this? Any thoughts? What value is driving this rule? Any thoughts on LinkedIn? It's not always clear, but so Stephen, I'll take the silence as a no. Data entry. Mm-hmm. But there's a value. Data entry is a process, false. It's not really a corporate value. Tell you what most people tell me. They tell me they think the value is something about standardization or consistency. But that's not a value either. That's a strategy. Let me show you the difference. You know, there's a TV detective monk in the US. There's a show where he's obsessive compulsive. That's how he solves his crime. For monk, if we have 8 glasses of water on the table, they all have to be the same height. It doesn't matter if the height is right, if it's good or bad. It just has to be the same. That's standardization as a value. Standardization as a value would say, we standardize everything. You should all be wearing the same clothes. You should be driving the same car. You should be doing the same work. That's standardization as a value. We don't do that at all. We standardize in order to achieve another value. So we might standardize our technology, our computers, because we want an economy of scale. We might standardize our hiring practices for fairness purposes. So we have a reason we're standardizing. This particular one, this is not about economy of scale, and this is not about fairness. So what's the value? Why are we doing this? And for every policy we have and every rule we have in the organization, we should be able to make these links. Any thoughts? What's the value here? Why do I care about standardizing? Why is it important to me to standardize the date? I'm going to give you just a few seconds to mull it over, and I'll... If anyone has a thought, okay. It's about accuracy or clarity. We want to get it right. We think we can get it right if we standardize it. That will help us get it right. And there are people who are going to say, that's not the way my department or my section does it. So we are going to need some kind of principle that says, well, accuracy is more important than your personal preference. Now I see we have a standard, a strategy of standardization to achieve accuracy. Now I can come up for what the policy is. And point of the policy, people, you really want people to look at the policy and say, good policy, everybody should have that policy. This is the right policy for us to be having. That's the kind of reaction you want. So I think the policy here is something like this. We use a single date format across all our systems. That's where you want people to go, right, that's what we should be doing. So if the policy is just, you must use YYYMMDD, we have no idea what's behind it. But when we raise the level up, our policy, it just happens that our particular standard is YYYMMDD, but our policy is to use a standard across the organization. That's the decision we've made. If somebody came to you in your organization and said, well, I don't care about accuracy, I think you'd probably say you may not be working for the right organization. If they said, I care about accuracy, but I don't think it should trump people's personal preference, we can now have an adult discussion about that. If they came and they said, well, I believe in accuracy, but I don't think we should be standardizing things, certainly not the date, or this isn't the standard we should choose, we can now have an adult discussion about that. But it's because we all have a mutual starting point, and it's a basic core value to the business that we all need to start from. And everything that you're doing and that you're asking people to do are driven in some way from these values. The difference between a value and a strategy is that if you are not true to your value, people will leave. If you said, we care about accuracy, and you don't care whether the information is right or not, people will leave. But if you said, we care about accuracy, but you don't standardize the date, are people going to leave? Unlikely. These core values are values because we hold them as individuals. We hold them to ourselves. So we align with the values of the business. And that's why we are driven to follow the policy. You've often heard people say, when you give people the policy, you have to tell them the why. And the usual why I hear is, what happens if you don't do it? That's not the why. You have to tell them the why means why the value of this policy is more important than what it is, the value of what you are pushing forward. And it's not to judge that their values are bad, but we decided accuracy is more important than personal preference. That's why we need your group to change to the standard format. So when we have wording like this, I'll take it right back to the beginning. I have no idea what value is behind this. This is just an order, a marching order. I don't know why. What it sounds like is they don't trust me. That's what it sounds like. It may have nothing to do with that at all, but that's the message I'm getting, and I certainly don't see the value in it. We're far likely to have people follow your rules when they understand how the rule aligns to the value of your organization, because they're using you because of your values, or they're working for you because of your values. So listen, some of this is a lot of stuff. You know, I've given you a few techniques. I actually teach a workshop last all day to go through a whole bunch of techniques. You may have some policy writers working for you that you think could benefit from from coming and practicing, learning some ways to reword things. So I've got a workshop coming up. But for most of us, this is really just, we need to just put it on the radar. You know what? I never thought of this before. I see it now. I'll fix it. That's what it is for most of us. So it's pretty straightforward. All right. I can open this to any other questions there, Stephen, if we have any coming in. If there are no questions, I'm crystal clear. Is that it? Clear.
No questions so far, but lots of comments about the value of this. And I know that a lot of Tech Canada members, tech chairs, were emailing about the recording of this session. So I'd just like to remind everyone that this session has been recorded and it will be available on techcanada.com. That is TEC-Canada.com, as well as on Tech Canada's YouTube channel, which is just the username Tech Canada. I don't see any questions coming in at the moment, Lewis. So I think everyone will give it another minute, and then we will wrap up for today's session.
Absolutely. I'll give you a few minutes back before the top of the hour. Mm-hmm. So, but I'm glad the message resonates with a lot of
people. I have a quick question, actually, too, about, you know, you've worked with organizations all across the globe. What's the best way, or should you involve employees in the creation of policy? Or if you should, and if so, what's the best way to go about that?
So I think generally, yes, you should involve employees in the creation of policy, but policy is an output of the strategy. So you should involve employees in putting together the strategy. The values, however, those come from the top. I've been at organizations where they say, we're going to pull all 5,000 people and we're going to vote on the values. I can tell you the kinds of useful values you end up with there, all right? It really doesn't give you a lot. So the values must come. The direction must come from the top of the direction. And then we have a strategy to how do we run our organization to meet that. Employees will be involved in that. And once you have your strategy, you come down to the employee level, the technical level, and say, all right, what rules are we going to need to support this strategy? What kind of standards, what kind of policy, procedures are we going to need?
Thank you. That's awesome. Perfect, everyone. Well, thank you very much for joining today's Deeper Insights webinar. It has been a pleasure, Lewis. Thank you very much for sharing your insights. I think everyone after watching this is going to be approaching the realm of policy creation differently. And thank you, comments are pouring in, appreciating today's session. Thank you, Terrence. For everyone, just a reminder, this has been recorded and it is available on TEC-Canada.com as well as our YouTube channel. Wishing everyone a safe and happy holiday, and thank you very much for joining. Thank you very much, Lewis.